You need to see
the
camera here. So I mean, this space maybe needs to remain.
Yeah, just
you tell us, right?
Joining us. If you tweet or Twitter and you want to tweet any of the comments, just use the hashtag Voix. You can also use the hashtag NewPlayTV. Voix is DESVOIX. So hashtag Voix, hashtag NewPlayTV. I'd like to welcome everybody. Thank you so much for coming to talk with us about Corinne. I think we're missing a couple people who are, I think there are a couple of women who aren't at this table. Where are they? So Liz, why don't you take a place at the table? And where is Mila? Come up here, please. And your compatriot is? Oh, Masha is there, okay. So you guys can, some people can sit over here, too. Okay, everybody wants to sit facing the audience. We're such theater people. Okay, so, it's just, in the DNA. I'm gonna turn this over, I'll do it. Exit sign, if in case of an emergency, there is an exit on the house right and the house left, and go out the front door. For those of you who don't know, my name is Amy Mueller, and I'm the Artistic Director of Playwrights Foundation, and we are a new play development lab here in San Francisco who champion playwrights in the development of their work and support them and the community in bringing new work to the U.S. theater primarily. Now we're sort of ready to get to something else. So what we're going to do is we are going to ask some questions, and we'll start by having I think what I'll do is pass the mic around, and everybody can introduce themselves. We'll start with the people who are currently at the table, and we're going to be asking a question, and people at the table will weigh in on the question. And then if there are any comments that are directly related to that, just, make yourself known. But at some point, probably in, 15 minutes after we get started, I'm gonna call some other people to come up to the table. These folks will become part of the circle, and the people at the table will talk about the second question, etc. Okay, so we're gonna, I'm gonna turn the mic over to Phil Arnoult, who's gonna give a little bit of context for today's conversation about international theater and international writing in particular, playwriting.
Good morning. I run something called the Center for International Theater Development. And it's really a front for me to get a lot of people into a lot of trouble. Most of my work has been in Eastern Europe, although I did spend a decade in East Africa. And about 10 years ago, there was really something new on the horizon in Russia. There were some new voices that were getting heard. And I've been taking a lot of Americans. Carrie was with me in Moscow a couple of years ago. Rob and Paige have been over in that part of the world with me. And indeed, there were some 60 individual Americans who went and saw the work of the Presnikov brothers, the work of Olga Mukina, these real pioneer playwrights, and got very excited about it. And then we saw the translations, and they were British translations. And they went over like a fart in an elevator to the Americans. So I was able to make that case, not fart in an elevator, I mean, some other way. And in 3 years, we ended up with a project that actually translated 26 new contemporary drama scripts by 14 live, living Russian artists, Russian playwrights, and it's on a CD, and if anybody would like a copy of these are American-English translations. One of them was a very successful adaptation where it was a translator and the playwright Kate Myra Ryan did Olga Mukina's Tanya Tanya. If you can just sign up, Susan Stroop over here works with me, and we'll make sure we get you one of those. A very interesting follow-up, though, was how to get new American work into Russia. And it was real clear that American playwrights were on a Mount Rushmore. It was Tennessee Williams and Eugene O'Neill and Arthur Miller and maybe half of Edward Albee, and that was about it. But there was this new writing movement in Russia. And there was an audience, I think, that was looking for, we believe there was an audience looking for new American voices. So I took four partners, people that I've worked with, institutions that I've worked with a year and a half ago to Russia, Sundance Institute, the O'Neill Center, Humana Festival of New Plays, and New York Theater Workshop. And these Americans spent 10 days talking to everybody and his brother, and recommended 23 scripts that we thought would be of interest to, from that very short but very deep connection. And then I told the Americans goodbye, and then actually there are two people at this table with the Russians who were a team of eight Russian readers who could read English, and they recommended seven plays. And four of them were adaptations with very well-known contemporary Russian writers. Yuri Klavdiev is a rock star playwright, and he translated Susan Laurie Park's Book of Grace. Misha Dornikov, another rock star, translated Annie Baker's Aliens. Vyripayev translated Bogosian's Talk Radio. Maxime Kushkin, who's gotten a lot of productions now in this country, translated Adam Rapp's first play, Nocturne. And then straight translations, not adaptations, of Chuck Me, new playwright Deborah Zoe Laufer, and Nilo Cruz. Those translations were finished about 6 or 7 months ago, and there were 8 mini-festivals all across Russia where there were readings of these plays, and I'm happy to say that right now Annie Baker is being called the little Chekhov, that there's a production opening of Annie's in Milena's Theater, there's a in Pavel's Theater. I think she's got 6 productions, 5 of Aliens and 1 of Circle Mirror Transformation, Susan Laurie Parks. It really was a magic key. And it also was a magic key for these colleagues of mine to be here, because it was a very successful project. It was funded by our government. Imagine that. The Medvedev, the president of Russia and the president of our country, the first visit, it was a state visit, Obama made was to Russia. And he bypassed Mr. Putin, because Mr. Putin was not the president. Mr. Putin was the puppeteer, the prime minister. Medvedev and Obama signed this thing called the Bilateral Presidential Commission. And this is why we all should read the international section of our newspapers. because it was a $50 million fund for education, culture, and sport. And somehow, some of it dropped into a cultural, a very aggressive cultural that Lee Brewer went over and directed a Sam Shepard play in a big project. And we were able to do this project with the American translations and these six people who are with us today who represent theaters from across Russia. They're young producers, directors, festival directors, and they're part of the name of the project is Beyond the Capitals, Not the Usual Suspects. These folks that you're going to meet today are in important places right now. In 10 years, they're going to be running a lot of important things. And in 20 years, they're going to be running everything. Really smart. We started in Baltimore. We spent 5 days in Austin, Texas. We're here and we go to New Orleans, which I think really shows what American theater is, not the East Village, as much as I love the East Village. But that's us, and we're really happy to be invited here. Sorry that took so long.
No, it's perfect. That was a really perfect introduction. Thank you, and it's fascinating. So what I'm gonna do is pass the mic around. Just introduce yourself, okay? So we have a sense of who's in the room. We'll pass it all the way around. And then I'm gonna ask, we're not gonna do that, just because of time. We're gonna just introduce people at the table, and then I'm gonna ask you guys to talk a little bit about a question that I have, okay?
Hello, I'm Milena. I'm from Russia, from St. Petersburg. America's happiness country, thank you. Thank you for us. I'm production director new theater in St. Petersburg, in the center of town, of city, for young directors, for young artists, for young actors. It's a new place. We find it 1 year ago, and it's a place for new drama, for contemporary project. We perform our shows daily, and from Russian, Italian, and American playwrights now. We have in repertoire now three plays from American playwrights. It's Aliens from Annie Baker, it's Big Love from Chuck Me, it's End Days from Deborah Zerlaufer, and we're planning books, Book of Grace. Yes. Two years ago we did the first Freak Festival in Russia, and we did a festival for every year we did a festival for young directors, and each year we performed 1935 shows for other directors, producers, for people, and yes, it's good. That's all.
Yeah, what you want to tell you? This is the only independent. This is a private theater. This is no state money. There's no ministry money. This is her vision. She runs an agency in St. Petersburg and Moscow, and is really committed herself to making this extraordinary, vibrant place in Petersburg.
So my name is Maria Krupnik, or just Masha, it's easy. I'm a freelance art manager and facilitator for contemporary drama and contemporary drama theaters in Moscow. I work with main four contemporary drama stages in Moscow, which is Praktika Theater, Doc Theater, Joseph Beuys Theater, and the Center for Drama and Directing of Kazantsev and Droshin. We're doing very different projects in Center of Drama and directing were project which name is Mr. Sky on the Gavar, which is the workshop for contemporary young directors, and we cooperate and doing the shows of contemporary Russian drama, American drama. We're cooperating with the Yale School of Drama. We did a project with Netherlands, and there are some other international projects are coming. And it is a place where the young directors can try their power, creativity, and do the draft productions, which will be judged by the committee of professionals, and the best show will stay in the theater.
I'm Robert Oppen. I locally write about theater for the San Francisco Bay Guardian. I'm along for the ride of this four-city tour, which is why I'm hanging out with these folks here. And I've also had a chance to go, particularly through Philip's auspices, to Eastern Europe and write on theater there recently for American theater.
I'm Marcus Gardley. It's a pleasure to be here. I'm born and raised proudly from the Bay Area. I live in Harlem now. And I'm here because my play, Every Tongue Confess, which is about 1990 church burnings in Alabama, was translated into French.
Thank you. I'm Samuel Gallet. I am a playwright for the this festival. I live in French, and I work with different theater in France. And I am also a member of the Coopérative Écriture. I think we are going to speak about this after.
Hi, I'm Liz Duffy Adams, and I'm a playwright, and mostly East Coast, New York, Massachusetts. And I work out, I'm so lucky, I sort of have a theatrical home in San Francisco, and been coming out here for like 12 years. And I'm here because my play is being translated into French, or I guess it has been. The Reckless, Ruthless, Brutal, Targeted, or the Train Play, which Rob directed in San Francisco like 10 years ago. Yay! And it's been a fantastic time, and thank you for bringing me.
Okay, good. So, first question I'm going to ask you guys here at the table to respond to, and I'm going to ask you to keep your responses to a minute or so, just so we can push forward. The first question has to do with, we're going to just talk a little bit about playwriting and the role of the playwright in various countries. So we'd like to hear a little bit about the past, and I think I'd like to keep it to about 10 years, 5 to 10 years. So what was the role of the playwright within the last 10 years before the present moment? What was the role of the playwright in your city, in your country, in your experience? The role of the playwright within the context of making theater.
It will be easy if we translate it. So to my point of view, 10 years ago, the thing that we now call the contemporary drama in Russia was only at the beginning. And it started with partly intervention from the British Council, which brought to Moscow the Royal Court people, which did the first verbatim trainings and masterclasses. And this format was so appreciated by the Russian playwrights because they had like classical training about what is a play, how it's done, how it's structured, but they were not dealing with the contemporary material and doing interviews and using the first-hand information in the making place. And this house started the theater doc. They were doing their bottoms. They did several very socially oriented and harsh and sharp plays, and they built a theater in the underground room of one of the houses. It started to attract the attention of the young theater doc.
DOC.
And how it started. And now it is growing and growing, and we cooperate with very different countries, and maybe I'll stop here.
I can say something very quickly. I think 10 years ago, what we saw in Russia was the beginning of voices that were fully formed after the political changes. I saw playwrights and I saw directors that straddled the old and the new. But 10 years ago was 10 years after those changes. And I think there's something very unique about both the directorial auteur voices and also the playwrights.
Maybe I'm a bit wrong, because maybe it started a bit earlier than 10 years ago. It is somewhere in the mid-90s. Yes. And the thing why it's happened, it is because the theaters, big theaters, Moscow theaters, regional theaters, were not accepting the young writers. And young writers has no way to realize themselves, to give their writing to, because dealing with the literary officials of the theaters was not very easy thing, and they were very aware of what's happening, but they were trying to use the classical texts and foreign texts that were already published and proved themselves. And there were no way to find the new writing in the theater at that time.
Well, this is a huge question, and I'm sort of, it's a bit daunting, but I'll say just from my own perspective, about 10 years ago here in the Bay Area, that was, you know, right after, in the wake of, immediate wake of 9/11, and for me, some of the strongest, most important work of new playwrights at that moment was done in highly collaborative situations with groups like Campo Santo, or were coming from outsider perspectives, particularly Middle Eastern perspectives, for example, in Golden Thread productions. But they were plays that were taking on and trying to ask the questions, make the debates, create the language and vocabulary and for what was happening, basically to pick up the slack where mainstream discourse had totally failed, I think, all of us in just succumbing to a narrow and kind of patent sort of top-down narrative. These were, so this was a very, I thought, a very productive and very passionate time in which a lot of very important work, which wasn't necessarily directly political, was coming out, and I think that was the immediate context for the work of the playwright as I saw it then.
Yes, I agree. I think 9/11 is definitely a marker for, at least in terms of aesthetically, in terms of aesthetics and playwriting. I think previously writers were told to were asked to write where they come from, and that 9/11 in a really interesting way sort of united us. And people were writing more about what was inside of them, some of the major questions that needed to be asked about our government and about how we interact with one another, which I think is important. I still feel like writers were expanding the form, which hasn't changed, you know, out of the School of Sublimatory Arts and Mac Wellman. And I feel like commissions really have changed the game a lot, because commissions, when they started, the unspoken language was write what we want you to write, and because we'll produce you. But you couldn't say that. So the writers were kind of confused, because they were trying to write what they were asked to write, but they couldn't write that. So now I think the language has changed where, in 10 years it's changed, where writers are saying, I need to write this, can you support this? And so what's really interesting is theaters are learning to support writers and not a play, which is becoming, which is having a huge impact in the United States, which is great.
I think there is lots of playwrights in France, and the huge interest for new writers and new playwrights in France. Lots of different aesthetics, and perhaps in the last 10 years, I'm not culture, but I think there is a development of contact with the other writers at the in other countries, and more theater who are interested to read the text for their rights. And so perhaps there is before the playwrights was often outside the theater, and now lots of people try to permit the playwrights find his place with the team of the theater in the theaters. So and not so all, but I think there is lots of meeting between the authors, the playwright, and lots of people try to not only with a cooperative, but try to work together and to find new way to write.
Oh, I'm so interested in what you guys are saying. I forgot to think, but I think two things in the last 10 years, I think there's sort of two different, from my point of view, trends or developments or ways that playwrights are thinking about things. And one is aesthetic in that I think it's possible, or maybe this is wishful thinking, that the idea that aesthetics the aesthetics of mainstream naturalism versus poetic nonlinear theater are not oppositional, but are on a continuum, and we don't have to be in our different camps. And that there's the kind of storytelling that playwrights do is not so rigid. I mean, there was a young woman in the audience last night at Marion's talkback who said, right, she was like, you know, this is great, this meta-theatricality, we don't have that here. Well, we don't have it in the mainstream. So I want to encourage her, she's probably not here, like, you know, Matt Bowman, other people. But it's been around for decades, but so I'm hoping that the barriers are breaking down, you know. Because it's, you know, theater is really ought to be bigger than that. And anyway, I think that's a conversation that's been happening. And the other thing is, you know, kind of a little bit like what you were saying about playwrights being a part of the theater and not on the outside. And that's a huge part of the conversation that's been developing. You know, people have complained about playwrights leaving the theater to write for television because, you know, they can make a living in the television, in television. And with Todd London's book, which every American here has read, Outrageous Fortune, pointing out that playwrights cannot make a living, and our government doesn't support individual artists. And you know, and Lynn Nottage, one year had the most produced play in America, and she couldn't live on the royalties, because for one thing, the original producing company theater took 40% of her royalties as sub rights, on top of other things. So anyway, so this is a huge conversation, and I'm hoping that this is something that now things are starting to shift around, and like, what are new models? And playwright collaboratives like 13P and not unlike your writers cooperative. These are new things that are maybe starting to build, and they're very interesting. Okay.
Very good. Wow, a lot of food for thought. So now I'm going to open it up to anybody who has a comment they'd like to make. Please introduce yourself before you speak.
Okay. So my name is Laurent Mühleisen. I am work in Paris as director of an international center dedicated to playwright translations into French called Maison Antoine Vitesse.
Hang on for just a second.
Which is a huge association of professional translators who dedicate themselves to translations of foreign plays into French, but also literary advisor at Comédie Française, as a French theater. That was really, which is not the purpose why I'm here.
That's why French. Also,
it's secondary in this context. And I wanted to react to what you said about what happened in Russia. I think, but I'm not sure, it's rather a question, that there is, from one part, the job of the royal court, not only in Russia, but rather in all the East, all the East Bloc after 90 or 91, which was quite a huge, aggressive politic of exchange and bringing new rules and new concepts. But I thought there has been also in Russia a tradition of people a little bit older than this generation of Filipayev and Brother Presnyakov, who started, for instance, with Kolyada in Ekaterinburg, with Ugarov, which began their careers during the communism, and who were the first that were aware about new possibilities to write new drama, incorporating the Russian tradition, which is a huge and solid tradition. I mean, not everything began only after 91. There are extraordinary plays of the 60s, the 70s, the 80s in Russia. But so I just wanted to ask if it's not all also a question of continuation of and of confrontation of different models within the Russian culture and with the, let's say, in a certain way, the Western culture, which is, for me, maybe more interesting, and you can start much more think with these connections that we're saying, okay, the royal court came and we discovered what's new writing, because you have a tradition of writing in Russia which is huge and which is wonderful.
Would you like to respond to that? And then if anybody else has something
they'd
like to say.
Yes, you're right. There were a workshop of Arbuzov, from which the Ugarov, I don't know about Koreda, but Ugarov, Elena Grimine, and some other playwrights appeared. It was bringing up atmosphere where they grow. And when the USSR collapsed, and they found out themselves without no way working with the theaters, because theaters were not accepting them. And theaters were not known what to do in this new situation of economy or what's happening in the country with all these things that started happening in the beginning of the 90s. And they found themselves that they need to organize something, and they starting uniting themselves and starting finding opportunities to build new theater. So yes, the beginning was with them. I'm not a historian of the theater. I know a very little bit about what happened in Yekaterinburg, but Yekaterinburg became the very important support for the theatrical life in Russia because of the Kolyada, because of the Bagayev, because of the plays that were appearing there. And it was completely unique thing. In the thematics that they were covering, in the understanding of the world, because they were speaking about very dark, very difficult, very painful things. And it was very difficult what was happening in Moscow. And there were another place on the Russian map, it was Tolyatti, where Vadim Livanov, who was working with the Young Spectator Theater at some point and was writing plays, and after he graduated from the Moscow Reader Institute, get back there, and he started understanding that there is no way that young writers can get their way into theater, and he united some young people around himself, and so the Togliatti effect appeared, where the Klavdiev, the Dorinko brothers, and some other young writers appeared, who are now like the most known writers in Russia. And it is very important, I think, for Russia, these small spots where the a bit older generation understand that they need to support the young writers. And they keep an eye on them, they suggest them opportunities. For example, the Lubimovka and Ugarov Yasnaya Polyana laboratories that they were doing, it was amazing thing. And it is not happening now because of the different things, economy, and there is no place, and there are no some less opportunities that they are now thinking about other things a bit. But it was a time which gave opportunity to young writers to get to know each other, to get to know young directors, to get to know young producers, and bring up some new projects.
I just want to say Nikolai Kolyada, K-O-L-Y-A-D-A, is a monumental figure in Russian theater. He's never bought into Moscow. He stays in Yekaterinburg. He'll take productions into Moscow, and they're mostly ho-hummed, and I'll take people to see the same productions, and you know, Bob Falls wanted to get his Tennessee Williams streetcar to Chicago. So there's one interesting article written by a woman named Murph Henderson in American Theater about 4 or 5 years ago on the Yekaterinburg scene.
I'm Lachlan Phillpott, I'm from Australia, and the country that was colonized by the British. I'm going to pick up on what you said too about the Royal Court and the fact that the Royal Court, a lot of British theatres seem to go into places and I feel make people, playwrights, feel like they're actually going in and saving them or showing them a new way. And it's concerning because I think that it's not necessarily the truth. I pick up on what you're saying, really kind of agree with, I guess, writers being in touch with their own history and their own culture. I guess the other thing that I kind of wanted to point out, other than you know the fact that in Australia I think we live in the shadow of a lot of particularly British traditions and kind of measure our work up to British traditions, and often the work isn't as good as what's being done in Australia anyway, is the impact on the internet, and particularly, I guess, if you live in an isolated place like Australia. I think that the fact that we live in a globalised world now has had a huge impact on writing and the theatre, and I'm curious whether that's so in Russia. I'm assuming that it's the same everywhere, but we have the opportunity to kind of make global collaborations, we have the opportunity to see work, to read work, to access people's manifestos or whatever, and I think it's something also that's shifted our audiences and their expectations, because if you can get on the internet and be entertained, or you can access a whole lot of information, then it also means that as playwrights, we have to actually step up to provide people with something that's more instantly accessible, possibly more confronting. And so I'm just kind of interested in what other people have to think about that.
Samuel, do you
want to
talk about that? Did you understand my
Okay. Sorry.
Vaughn, did you translate that?
Yeah.
You can say it out loud here on the mic. Is there plenty of French?
Carry on.
Liz, would you like to answer that? No.
Okay.
You
want to
say something?
I just wanted to say that I'm very interested in what you just said, because I was at the CUNY Graduate Center in New York does a lot of international theater events and does wonderful international theater events, and the Royal Court was there with their project with Syrian, Moroccan and Lebanese playwrights. So I saw some of these readings and I thought, my God, this is naturalist theater. This is Tennessee Williams. What the hell is this all about? And then I kept my mouth shut because I don't know anything else. But it's very interesting what you just said, because I think that kind of confirms an anxiety in my life.
Yeah. This is Judith Miller, by the way.
Désolé, but I'm sorry to not speak English, but for how it is, I think it's better.
Je pense que par rapport à la réaction,
Oui, là, oui, ok. Par rapport à la question du monde globalisé, des échanges, etc., chacun dans le groupe qu'on forme en France d'auteurs a une esthétique très différente, à sa propre carrière, son propre travail, et en même temps l'intérêt qu'on trouve à travailler ensemble et ensuite à pouvoir rencontrer des autres auteurs à l'étranger, et donc de pouvoir faire, comme on a fait ici, le bal littéraire, d'autres concepts qui sont portés par la coopérative d'écriture, c'est vraiment un moyen artistique et intellectuel pour confronter des points de vue différents sur le monde.
So Sam has just said that everybody is aware of globalization, it's having an impact on the kind of theater that people are doing, but also the cooperative work that they're doing together, doing these literary balls, working together, and even though each playwright is developing his or her own aesthetic, and there's very strong consciousness of that, the cooperative work allows them to confront these different aesthetics and sort of understand their place in the literary world through the aesthetics that they're developing.
Peut-être juste dire, pour ceux qui ne savent pas ce que c'est que la coopérative d'écriture, plus précisément, c'est un groupe d'auteurs, donc de 13 auteurs français, qui se sont réunis sous l'impulsion de Fabrice Melchior, dont certaines pièces sont traduites ici, et qui travaillent ensemble sur différents concepts. Donc il y a ce bal littéraire, donc d'écriture collective, mais également des fenêtres avec vue, où on travaille à partir du matériau de la presse, donc de l'actualité, d'autres concepts comme les consultations poétiques, où l'enjeu c'est de pouvoir écrire très rapidement avec les gens qu'on rencontre, avec les lieux où on arrive, et de multiplier, comme je disais, des points de vue et des esthétiques différentes, des modes de représentation différents.
Ok. Samuel is talking especially about the writers' cooperative to which he belongs with 13 other writers in France, right? And they have a multiplicity of things that they do together, even though each one is writing from his or her own aesthetic. And one of them was this kind of literary ball that we saw in which people create a piece together by creating a storyboard and developing different parts of it and inserting songs, and that's what we saw in dance. Part of it also is a kind of documentary theater that they do. And I kind of remember this. Based on newspaper reports and so on. So they'll build things out of that. And then the third one is located in specific spaces, right? So they're interested in exploring specific spaces. And each writer comes to these different projects with their own aesthetic.
Les esthétiques, ce que ça pouvait être avant, c'est que des auteurs puissent s'opposer avec des esthétiques. Et là, je dirais que le travail en commun des auteurs font que les esthétiques ne s'opposent plus dans une sorte de chose comme ça où on discute à la table autour de nos travaux respectifs, mais s'agencent.
And the result of all of this is that the aesthetics, instead of feeling as if they're opposing each other, so I come with this way of thinking that theater should be like this, and I come with this way that theater should be, this kind of movement from aesthetic to aesthetic, and a kind of, I think, a developing aesthetic that happens within the group because of this. Not that people give up their own aesthetic, but there's obviously some manipulation, some movement, right?
Can I just sort of, whoa, and then, yeah, I just, one little tiny thing is, I think we all have to, in a sense, we all have to resist colonization, even, you know, internally, you know, like playwrights in America have to resist the pressure to colonize their own aesthetic to find production. and the major places that produce sometimes exert a kind of aesthetic colonizational pressure, and I'm still jet-lagged. Anyway, that makes any sense, but I suddenly realized I totally related to that English-Australian thing. Okay.
I'm Nathalie Fillion, one of the playwrights. I'm here because my play has been translated. I'm also a director. Maybe about your question, I think we French people somehow have, anyway, another tradition. And the way we're colonized, I wouldn't say it's about playwriting, it's more by through TV or movies, things like that. Because in the playwright, we still have, we're still very influenced by, there's still a big work on language itself, and linked to poetry, linked to literature somehow, or Latin theater also, which is still like, yeah, we come from Latin theater.
And we sometimes we forget about it, but you can still feel it, you know, and in some writing. So I don't feel so much this colonization in the play writing, but more in the whole imagination process, you know, all narratives on TV, movies, and so on. I would say that. That's also why sometimes it's difficult to export French plays. But it happens, see, we're here. And I don't think we have the three of us, especially British kind of writing, not at all, not at all. And though we're here, so it's fantastic.
I just wanted to respond to your comment about, or your question about the internet and its impact on theater in the United States. Twitter is having a huge impact. Word of mouth is still the most powerful marketing tool. And so Twitter is a really great way to, look, I'm at a play, it's really great, come see it. So theaters are really taking advantage of that. You also see in terms of blogs that bloggers are becoming theater critics and people are really paying close attention to that, which is really great. I had a really powerful experience. A few months ago, I went to see Water by the Spoonful at Harvard State, which just recently won a Pulitzer. And it was maybe even in previews, and the play, 70% of the play takes place online through these chat rooms. And so half of the audience was laughing, they were very young, and half of the audience was clearly upset, they were much older. And so an older lady walked up to me and she said, "What is so funny? What is funny about this play?" And I tried to explain that, and I realized she didn't understand how a chat room works. And so it was a really great way of actually engaging her. And when she understood it, she explained to her husband, and at Act Two, this was an intermission, they were laughing. And so I thought, you know, there's something obviously the theater needs to do to introduce this world of play to the audience. But there was a really great moment where I felt like, you know, what I really try to do in my work is unite younger people and older people, people from different backgrounds, people who speak different languages. Theater has the power to do that. Nathalie said a couple of days ago, yesterday, theater is one world, and I really believe that. And so what I hope that the internet can do is actually help us start a conversation in our own communities with people who we live next door to, who just are actually are from a different generation. And I think it does have the power to do that.
Great.
If I can
add something about French theater, I would say, the main difference also, because maybe I'm a little darker, it'll sound a little darker than Sam will say, because nothing has really changed. I mean, France is still, the main landscape is very classical, and the contemporary playwrights, I feel, we live in a little ghetto, and things are going a little better, little by little. Very slowly, and so in another way, maybe. So they don't need us. I would say I don't feel I'm needed in my own country. So it's so important to be abroad, because then when you, but also when you're not needed, then you're totally free. I mean, I feel because they don't expect anything for me, you know, and it's a paradox, maybe, but this Evans, like going abroad, I mean, for me, I don't know for you, but it's then we come back home with a little very sexy area, you know. So thank you so much, because at home I don't feel needed.
Surely you have an audience. I mean, I guess what you're saying about you know, the growth of an audience through a play that's looking at the internet means that you're getting a new lot of people in and building a new audience, which, I mean, I'm curious if you're talking about the sort of audiences that you're getting to see theatre in France, and the implication is that you're losing the audiences of a particular type and that they're not coming to see the work, or that they're not interested in the work. Is that, am I understanding that right?
No, it's that we have many, how to say, it's a very sophisticated system, and with many, many theatres, national theatres all over the countries, where there's money everywhere. I mean, this theatre are rich. I would use a metaphor. This is like castles. There are still many castles with many kings, not many queens, just many kings. And these castles are just beginning to open for playwrights. They'll just, how is it, point of view? Just a bit. Now, what has slowly changed is that there are some kings and one or two queens who are playwrights, who now own the castle, some castles. So that is it's stupid to use this metaphor. It's easier for you. But it's so then suddenly you can come in the castle and say, oh, wow, that's fantastic. Because then you have all the means, you know, to, and there's money, of course. Also, I would say that in France, what is complicated also is that there are many kind of subsidies, many helps, but they're not linked to each other. And the main difficulty is that you can be helped for writing, for instance, really. You can have money for writing, but then to be produced, it's something else. And that's the main difference, which I appreciate a lot in Germany or in Great Britain, whatever you can think about them, you know, the way. It's that when they're interested in a play, they want to go to the production. And in France, we are very, very often, you know, there are so many readings. You write a very good play, and you're invited everywhere for reading. And then, you know, everybody thinks that they've seen the play, and it's over, and it will be produced. And it's all kind of French paradoxes. It's not only in the cooking, you know. It's French paradoxes almost everywhere. It's a little bit simplified, but
I think it's important to talk about the role of directors. Because France has been a director's theater for really a long time. And so, and directors run these subsidized houses. So they get to do what they want to do. And either they have one or two playwrights that they like to work with, or they take a classic and redo it. And this is starting to stop, right? This is changing, I think. But there are not very many houses, very many theaters, subsidized theaters, that are dedicated to new playwrights. There are hardly any. And so that's a real problem for young
writers. So,
So, can we pass the microphone? We're going to take her comment. I'm going to ask you to hang on to your comment. And what we're going to do after you're done, okay, is I'm going to dismiss everybody at the table and bring other people up to the table, okay? And we'll carry on from there.
I want to say about my experience for my French friends. 4 years ago, I came in St. Petersburg from Moscow, and I looked that it's a city museum. It was many, many beautiful theaters, which in each theater a seat one king. So, It's in theater, not places for young directors, not only kin. And I come in one big theater with budget 30 million dollars in 1 year. And I come in and said, please give me a chance. I did a very interesting laboratory in your theater. Please give me one chance. And I come in to municipality.
City.
Yes, and I give the grant, my first grant and we're doing first festival laboratory. We perform 19 shows in this theater. It's very, very classic theater. It's very famous, very, very old theater. And first days, 7 days in this theater come in very, very young people. It shows we did very, very creatively. It's a place from Yugoslavia. It was a place from Yugoslavia. Misha Dominkov, you know this. Pavel Prishko, Olga Mukhina, many different Russian playwrights. Yes, you understand. Excuse me. And after this festival laboratory, we understand that
So in the newspapers there were a statement that it was a revolution. So the 4 years already passed, but still lots of directors in the St. Petersburg theaters pretend that nothing had happened. So in Moscow, our festival and what we are doing is more known than in St. Petersburg.
No.
But. But after the festival that we did in that theater started being visited by the younger audience.
Работы молодых режиссеров оказалось, что за три года во всем городе поставили спектакль только три молодых режиссера.
And when I was doing my research about what was happening with the work of young directors in St. Petersburg and in the theaters, I found out that during this period only three young directors did their production within 3 years in St. Petersburg.
Теперь каждый год, вот, в прошлом году, восемь режиссеров поставили спектакль в разных театрах.
And during last year, already eight young directors did their productions during the year. In different theaters around the city.
Yes, и четыре театра берут наших режиссеров уже каждый год на постановки.
And already four theaters in St. Petersburg are working with the young directors that we brought up and giving them opportunity to stage and to produce their production in the theaters in the city.
Next question.
So are these directors also working with the young writers as well?
Yes, mainly yes.
Я думаю, что сейчас, когда у нас есть свое место, своя площадка, мы к нам приходят эти короли.
And now when we have our own venue, these kings are coming to us. But not everybody.
That's a great way to end this this table.
So thank you. You guys can go sit down. Nathalie, why don't you come up, and Marion, lost my hand for a second, and Octavio, please, Carrie, would you like to say, please, and the man next to you, yes, and this young woman from Bulgaria, yes. So, and let's see, Chris, why don't you sit down too? So, we started to talk about, you know, sort of the what playwriting was or what the role of the playwright was like, and we sort of morphed into what it is now because it's so present for us, and that's really great. So. I think what I'd like to pose this question, given where we are with time, and the caveat being that if you want to address something that was addressed previously, you can. But we're going to move on with the question.
No, my comment was really earlier, so it's fine.
It's okay. Well, we'll get back to you.
I'm happy to hear the conversation.
Okay, we'll get back to you. So the question is, in the future, what would you like to see as the role of the playwright in our theater, in your theater, in the theater that you want to participate in, or you'd like to see people coming up participating in? What would be the role of the playwright if you could imagine your dream?
Kings and queens. What you said?
Introduce yourself, tell us a little bit about you.
Okay, my name is Ida Daniel. I'm from Sofia, Bulgaria. Shortly, maybe I should say what had happened in the last 10 years in Bulgaria with the playwrights. It's maybe similar to Russia in a way, because we all had these 20 years of things happening. Maybe the most interesting thing is that the inertia of playwrights from the past, when it ended, there was a kind of vacuum that nothing could happen. And then some young poets or story writers decided to step into theater, which was really an interesting event. But still, it was like for once they do it and then they go back to their major interest. And maybe there is only one woman, her name is Yana Borisova, and she came from curating fine arts, but she's really doing great work in contemporary playwright, which is, I can say, mainly influenced by maybe some British, but some Spanish and French drama, I can say. And now what's very interesting, and I think this is the way in future we can have some kind of place for playwrights, is that a lot of friends decide to develop work together. Either they're poets that maybe are like this French cooperative, they try different things and support each other. They make performative readings of their poetry, switching places. They do not read their own poetry, but the poetry of their colleagues. So this kind of developing in process, which gives chance for the new forms to develop, or the new language that is there to come into form, because exactly this is the problem, that we do not have the support of the kings, and they do not understand what we are talking and doing. They plainly come to you and they say, "I don't understand your many surfaces," but they never like try to. So yeah, maybe that's it. But I think that the grasping reality together is what, you know, I think the future should hold. Very good, thank you.
My name is Yuri Urinov. I was a director in Russia. Now it seems to me that I'm director in the U.S. for the last 3 years. And as a director coming from the background of a director's theater, I must say I actually kind of like the competitiveness that exists there between playwrights and directors. I think there is something healthy about that, and I think some very interesting results come out from this competitiveness. When I say competitiveness, I obviously don't mean that director kills the play or playwright or playwright dominates over the directing process. I think this balance of friendship and competition between these two professions, from my point of view, actually creates more, gives more than takes away. And I think one specific thing that we found out while working on the program on the contemporary Russian drama here was that Russian playwrights of the new wave, I believe, are pretty much ready for the directors to come in and play around with their work. And if you look at the plays of Muhina or Korchkin or anybody else from this wave, I think there is some kind of openness. I think playwrights do realize, conscious on the conscious or subconscious level, that there will be a next step, and they are trying to leave more opportunities for director and actors and designers to work with the play. And here and that's what is different with the big chunk of American playwriting here, that I think there is something healthy about playwright giving is writing a play as a proposal for the future development, then unlike writing the final resultative product.
I'm Carrie for a laugh. I have found it sort of in the last decade in the States both sort of thrilling at the rise of the focus on the playwright, but also somewhat dispiriting in the sense that most of great theater comes out of people who are total people of the theater, not just interested in an aspect of it, but, you know, anybody, Sophocles, Brecht, Mayakovsky, you know, I mean, Natalie's a director, Marion's also an actress, you know, that to make theater, you have to be of the theater. It helps to know how theater is made. It helps to be interested in design and architecture and in writing and directing and in audiences, in acting. The more immersed you are in the world of it, the more the work will actually be of the theater and not a pale imitation of film and television. And this country tends, you know, Americans are highly specialized, so we get MFAs in one thing, this sort of obsessive graduate specialization in an area, which I'm not sure in the long run is perhaps the most fertile way to make work. And I always wish we'd see more playwrights running theaters. Boards are very suspicious of this, and it's a shame because I actually think it would be a great thing for writers to actually see that landscape from that perspective. You know, I totally understand that writers feel like they don't have a place at the table, but everybody feels that way. The table is so tiny that we're all hanging onto the lip of the table with this pathetic desperation, you know. And one of the things that's happening, and I see it because we also run a school, is that theater's being created in all kinds of different ways. Devised work is happening. I've been working in Canada a lot, which is much more porous about directors, writers, playwrights, actors switching roles a lot, making work that way. Tends to make for more sort of interesting material. You know, I would hope that the role of the playwright is always the provocateur, you know, the chicken in the hen house, or the fox in the hen house, rather, and that, you know, the less interested we are in trying to imitate other media and the more interested we are in trying to exploit what is uniquely theatrical and live about theater, the more hope there is, I think, for the muscularity of the field as a whole. The other thing I would say, which is very funny for us as Americans, is the French tradition is exactly opposite, right? You know, this absolute obsession with classical theater. In this country, nobody reads anything anymore. Nobody knows even anything that was written in the 70s. Nobody remembers that Maria Irene Fornes changed the face of the American theater. We've just forgotten she exists. We've forgotten Adrienne Kennedy exists. We don't read Lorca. We don't read, I mean, it's unbelievable. So we always have this sort of weird arrogance that we've invented meta-theatrical theater. What happened to Mayakovsky in 1915, you know, whatever. It's sort of amazing. We're just not interested in this country. There's no support for classical theater. There's no support for acting ensembles. And so, you know, I think we could really fertilize playwriting in this country by actually a wider aperture of where we've come from.
Je suis Marion Aubert et je suis auteure dramatique et comédienne, et j'ai une compagnie en France qui est associée à un théâtre, à la Comédie de Saint-Étienne. Et peut-être, pardon? Everybody understood?
So, my name is Marion Aubert. Not my name, obviously. Her name is Marion Aubert. She is an actor and a director, and she has a company, and it's associated to a theater in Saint-Étienne.
Et voilà, comme j'ai pas tout suivi au débat, peut-être que je vais dire des choses qui ont déjà été dites et je m'en excuse. Mais je voulais aussi soulever un autre problème, je ne sais pas s'il est spécifiquement français, mais par rapport à l'écriture contemporaine, on a, nous aussi, je crois, un problème avec le public. C'est-à-dire que les directeurs de théâtre, les barons dont parlait Nathalie, pensent bien souvent, je parle en mon nom, j'ai l'impression, pensent à la place de leur public. Donc ils décrètent que le théâtre contemporain, ce n'est pas pour eux. Donc ça va à l'inverse de ce que tu disais, tu me dis Judith quand tu dois... Je finis, je vais au bout de ma pensée. Et donc en France, j'ai l'impression que le théâtre contemporain est souvent suspecté. On associe le théâtre contemporain à un théâtre complètement abscon, encore maintenant hermétique. On se dit c'est pas pour moi. Et du coup, alors que le terme même de contemporain, c'est... étymologiquement, le théâtre qui se fait avec les autres, avec ceux qui sont vivants aujourd'hui. Et moi, bien souvent, dans les salles, je vois que je ne m'adresse pas à mes contemporains, c'est-à-dire que les spectateurs ont tous à peu près 60... Oui, très, très souvent dans le... génération, et c'est un vrai problème. Tu as déjà peut-être traversé ça.
I'll end with what Marion just said. She said that it's very difficult to be doing theater because the audience is about my age. This is me, not her age, my age. Sort of old fart, 60-year-old types, right? And she's wondering where people her age are and if she's going to have to be retired before she meets an audience the same age that she is, which is a worrisome thing. But to get back to what she said earlier, it connects to what Carrie was saying, that directors of theater in France, Marion feels, are always speaking on behalf of their public. They seem to feel that they know more than the public itself knows what the public wants, and they think that contemporary theater is not what they want and not that what they can handle, because it's too abstruse, it's too hermetic, and contemporary does not translate, as my own would translate, as what we make together, because we're thinking together, because we're part of the same universe, but rather it's that which is difficult to understand. I think that Nathalie would probably say the same thing in some way. Yeah, but this particular kind of, this is another problem that she wanted to bring up about what's happening in French theater right now.
Donc voilà, la question du public, pour moi, est vraiment essentielle, parce qu'il ne faut pas oublier que c'est surtout, et je regrette qu'il n'y ait pas de public aujourd'hui, mais on fait aussi du théâtre pour les gens, on ne le fait pas uniquement pour soi. Et donc l'espoir, s'il faut parler d'espoir, c'est qu'effectivement, de plus en plus, effectivement, les auteurs ont une place dans les théâtres et deviennent visibles aussi. Et je crois que... avec des concepts comme le bal, d'un seul coup de voir que l'auteur est vivant, que l'auteur... je trouve plus mes mots. Mais d'un seul coup, effectivement, de rencontrer que des jeunes spectateurs, des lycéens se disent « Ah tiens, l'écriture est vivante » et donc... je trouve plus mes mots. En tout cas, ce que je veux dire, c'est que de rendre l'auteur visible dans la cité, à mon avis, c'est ramènera davantage de public au théâtre et redonnera peut-être, je l'espère, un souffle.
So what Marion hopes for the future is the author is going to be more visible, and more visible in the life of making theater, which is one of the reasons why these literary balls are so important, because they bring in a lot younger audiences. The kids love this stuff, right? The high school kids like it. They get it. They get that there's a way that art can be life at the same time. It can evolve their energies in a different kind of way.
Et qui peuvent s'identifier d'un seul coup, de changer les représentations, ça me semble éminemment important. Nathalie parlait tout à l'heure des places de la femme. Alors, il y a très peu d'auteurs femmes en France, et d'un seul coup, quand des jeunes gens se disent ah tiens un auteur ça peut avoir cette tête là, ça peut être ça peut avoir ce corps là, d'un seul coup ils se disent peut-être moi aussi j'ai pas besoin de m'appeler Victor Hugo, d'avoir une barbe pour écrire, pour être un artiste. Et j'ai l'impression qu'on a besoin d'avoir d'autres représentations et qu'on a voilà, c'est pour ça que je parle de cette visibilité là pour moi.
And the visibility is also very important in terms of gender issues, because there are not very many women writers in France, and there aren't very many women directors, and as we've heard earlier, there aren't very many women who run theaters.
How long are we going to hear that?
Yeah, I know, we've been doing it for a long time, Terry. and so if women authors are particularly involved, one sees their faces, one sees their writing, one hears their voices, one sees their bodies, one can say, oh hell, I don't have to be Victor Hugo to do theater.
Nobody knows Victor Hugo.
No, I think people...
We know where the lame is.
Le misérable. Le misérable.
Your question is a very difficult question, Amy, about future. You know, I've been working a lot the last 5 minutes. And I feel very very close to what Carrie says. Also, because we also have, not maybe as much as here, but this word of specification for me is just death. And I was an actress, I'm now playwright and director, I teach, as you do also. And I am sure theater is one word, and just we move into one same word. So I want to bring that very close, I could say the same. That to say, I would just then add something about words, maybe, because I think in the future we can be also, or just remain, keep on working on words for those who think that words still can speak, you know, in a world of images, of pictures, of this specificity maybe to keep and something like that. Words can still speak, you know.
Hi, I'm Octavius Willis. I'm a playwright here in San Francisco. I've been here since 1989. I came from Texas. And I've been thinking about your question, Amy, but I've been thinking also about some other things that have been coming up in the discussion. I'll start there. I actually don't mind my outsider status, my outcast status as a writer. I kind of enjoy that. I don't want to be a king or a queen. I'm happy being the court jester. I want to be the holy fool. I'm not sure I want to be an artistic director of a theater, because I'm already an artistic director of my mad thoughts. And that's enough. That's often enough. I do want the same visibility that Marion is calling for. I think that's really important to kind of have that same status. But without the sort of traditional hierarchies, if we could explode those, that would be terrific, so that we're constantly having to redefine them. Always, you know, there's someone at the top and someone below that and someone below that, and always the ones at the very bottom of that whole tier are the set builders. They have the least importance. And I think if there's some way to shift that model so that even the set builders are artists in the room as well, so that we all feel that we're participating in the creation of this crazy animal called play, and that our contributions are as important and matter and have an effect on the work. I like my plays being porous enough that they can respond to the influences of everyone in the room. And I want to see more of that happen in the future. I want to see I like my own singular vision, but it's a hollow vision if it doesn't respond to, if it isn't fired through the prism of everyone else's own ideas. It's important to me to have that happen in the room. But so that's sort of what I would like to see in the future. I'd like to see more of that. I'd like to see more artists collaborating from outside the fields of theater. I want to bring in filmmakers into the theater. I want to bring in musicians, hip-hop artists. I want to bring visual artists, sculptors, painters, not just scene builders, but real, you know, painters and people from, I want to bring poets, people who are not accustomed to writing for the theater. I want to see them working in the theater. I just want that more cross, that cross-pollination to happen more aggressively in the future. So.
So I'm Pavel Shishin, I'm a repertory director for the theatre company, which is based in Omsk, in Siberia, it's a long way from here. And I should say that theatre in Russia is divided into two large groups, that is the theatre of Moscow and St. Petersburg and the theatre of all other regions of Russia. So I believe I should speak from the point of view of provincial theatre here. And I'm not very optimistic about contemporary playwriting in Russia nowadays, and I'll give you some figures. There are three major playwriting competitions held annually in Russia, and there appear about 1,500 new plays every year in Russia. But you must have noticed that we have been mentioning the same names throughout our conversation. There's a Kurochkin, Claudia, and so on, but there are far too, well, there are much more playwrights, so-called playwrights, because once I read 450 plays that entered the list of a playwright competition, Eurasia, which is held by Nikolai Kalida, which was mentioned here in Yekaterinburg, and I couldn't find a play that I would be happy to produce at my theatre company, unfortunately, so there were 450 plays. So, I'm not very optimistic about contemporary playwriting, sorry. And I believe that I'm, at least in province outside Moscow and St. Petersburg, there will be tendency to produce, to go on producing classics, Russian classics and world classics. So I think we'll keep to that then. And I think there is some optimistic note to that. I think there will appear more works based on prose. And there has been appearing quite a number of works based on prose staged in various cities throughout Russia, in Siberia, in Far East, in very small theatre companies, say in Minusinsk, which is about 30,000 people only, but has a very good theatre company there. Then, so prose will appear on stage. Then I am sure that there will appear some more devised works, because it's a very new trend in Russian theatre. We haven't been producing or making devised works in Russia. Well, I can remember only one theatre company, which is not Russian, but which is from Almaty, from Kazakhstan, a former USSR republic, which makes a very good devised theatre. This is Art and Shock Theatre Company. And they tour quite a lot in Russia, and I believe that there will appear some companies which will produce this kind of work. Well, it's new and it's very interesting, and I know that some works of this kind have been produced in St. Petersburg and in Moscow. That's it. And I don't think that many plays by contemporary playwrights mentioned here and not mentioned here will be produced in provincial theatre companies. Unfortunately, we have a very, very, very traditionalist audience, you know, the audience who knows perfectly well why they want to go to the theatre, and most of them want to go to the theatre to be entertained. And
What's the next play opening in the theatre?
In my theatre, I'm coming back to open The Aliens, a play by Annie Baker. We are very unusual company, in fact. But I think why I have chosen Annie Baker, because it's, as Philip said, it's kind of Chekhov, you know. And when I was a part of that playwriting program, A New American Plays for Russia, and I was a reader, and I read 10 plays out of 26, and when I read Annie Baker's play, The Aliens, I said that that is Chekhov, and so I thought it should be produced in my company. Well, it is not. It feels like
And yet she is not.
She is not. She is not. She feels like it, you know. Well, it is very close to us.
My name is Christopher White, and I'm the artistic director of a company here in San Francisco called Mugwumpin, who creates exclusively devised work. And it's interesting for me because I actually arrived at making devised work through working in new play development. And I lived for a couple of years in Dublin, Ireland, and created a play development program at a place called Project Arts Center in Dublin, and ran that for about 6 months before it ran out of money. The playwrights there were really hungry to get out of a certain kind of literary rut that they were in, coming out of a very sort of heavy Irish tradition of playwriting and looking for ways of breaking out of that. And they were really hungry for different ways of collaborating. They wanted to get out from behind their desks and be more engaged with the process of making theater, to not be trapped in a sort of purely literary way of thinking about the plays that they wrote. And so the program that I started focused a lot on sort of pairing up playwrights with all different kinds of artists from the theater, including designers or, you know, directors or actors, to really find a way for them to get out from behind their desk and be able to collaborate a lot more. And this was really juicy to me. And so when we ran out of money and eventually I came back here, I wanted to start making more and more collaborative theater. And so now we're at the point where we do end up with a script, but it's the artifact of the process rather than the starting point of the process. And yeah, so all of us sort of have to be, we have to be fluent in all different kinds of aspects of theater, and the visual aspects, and also the acting, and also the writing, and it's very rich. And at the same time, so as I look towards the future, I'm interested in exploring different models by which devised work can become also a collaboration with writers as well. And I know that Robin Page just recently did a devised piece with Cutting Ball, working with Eugenie Chan, and it's something that we with Mugwumpin haven't done yet, of working directly with a playwright. And partly it's I think that there's a certain amount of anxiety on our part that we don't know how to work with the playwright, and the playwright doesn't know how to work with us. And so I'm really interested to see in the U.S., you know, I mean, for example, like Playwrights Foundation, it would be awesome to see some sort of endeavor that has, you know, the development of the play and the devising process going sort of hand in hand, and finding different ways or different models that might be able to function.
Great. So responses from you guys out there. Anything pop up or something you'd like to add to the conversation? Michelle, you actually have the mic. So
I know. I have the mic.
I'll say. This is, there we go.
Stand up and then introduce yourself, because we got you on TV.
Hi.
Hi, I'm Michelle Hayner. I don't have to speak the whole time standing up, do I? I feel a little...
I don't know.
She goes a little too Oprah.
Why don't you sit here? This will be the seat.
So this is the your turn to speak chair.
Yeah.
So I'm Michelle Hayner, and I'm here in the more official capacity as co-translator with Emily Jane Cohen of On West by Nathalie Fillion. And I've had all kinds of, I had some specific thoughts earlier before this panel started, and then of course hearing from you guys has stirred up all kinds of other thoughts. I think the thing I actually want to speak to is, before I want to talk about the internet, but is this sort of role of devised theater and collaborative theater, and then the role of the playwright in that. And this kind of comes from my own particular background, in that I actually trained in Paris at a school called École Jacques-Lecoq, which is very much about devised theater, and where devised theater becomes absolutely run-of-the-mill. And it's tremendously empowering in this sense of creating theater makers and creating groups of people who are used to shifting roles and who are all responsible for the work together, even as, I would say, sort of different specializations emerge within that. And I do think that devised and collaborative and more site-specific work and more physical theater work is very much something which it certainly has roots deeper in the 20th century, but which I think is very exciting and relevant and present today. And I know both from my own experience, and I think from the companies that are creating work that's more, has a little more to it, that the role of the writer within those collaborative groups is very important. I know groups that I've been in where there was the absence of a writer. We had some pieces that had all kinds of great things, but really lacked some kind of weight to them. And I think of Charles Mee, who's been brought up, and I was talking to him about him yesterday, where I think within Anne Bogart's company, it's very important the presence of that writer. And so the thing that I would really like to add, though, is while I think that in this moment of finding theater's place and possibility, this particular moment of the 21st century, and I think that theater is at the moment of a new renaissance, in fact. I do, because I think that theater offers something in this world of technology that people are actually hungry for. Because I think that the kids today get that those things that they're hooked to are just tools. That they really get it, that it's just tools, and the stuff that really matters to them is this. And that those things are just stuff. I think that they get that, and I think that theater reminds them of that. But to me, it's les grands poètes, ça me fait penser dans trois vitesse, that my great question in this moment of devised and collaborative generation is yet, what will remain 50 years from now, 100 years from now, 200 years from now? And thus, I think we have a responsibility to find and to cultivate and to nurture this writers, les grands poètes, the Sophocles, the Shakespeares, not to put too much weight on you guys, but of our generation, I think that there's something that is carried in the language that is part of the heritage of theater, and I think that while I'm very interested in the physical theater world, there's something in seeking out and supporting these voices of these great poets that where we have also a particular responsibility right now. And I think that this colloquium is part of that. So, sit to,
that's it.
Yeah.
So, pass the mic to her. She'll come sit here.
Okay, all right.
I was
thank you. Thank you. I'm Kimberly Jenner, and I'm here as translator with Eric Butler of Marion's wonderful play. Excuse me. And just, there are many, many things here. To respond to, but I've grouped my responses into three. Two things that make me grumpy, and one that gives me hope. And the subject headings for the grumpy things are crushing commercial pressures and an illiterate public. So I'll start with the illiterate public. And you know, by that I mean three things: linguistically, theatrically, and culturally. We're working with a public who is increasingly less able to read, less interested in reading anything, let alone plays and new plays.
theatrically illiterate because I'm a professor at UC Santa Cruz and I adore my students, but they don't have a wide exposure to contemporary theatrical cultures. And then of course culturally illiterate as the humanities are being less and less valued in the university and our students are getting less and less of a sense of their cultural past, their history, the possibilities of the future in the rest of the world, then we have to understand that our theatrical possibilities are shrinking as the humanities, as history, as literature, as language is taught less and less. Crushing commercial pressures, which is something I think a lot of what people have said here is based on, but we just haven't said it out loud yet. There are some theaters in the region who are thinking about going to a 2-week rehearsal process with one week in tech. I know many of you know this. Obviously, under such conditions, new work cannot develop. How could you devise a piece in 2 weeks and then tech it? Art is seen as a commercially successful item. You guys were talking earlier about directors thinking that they know what their public wants. I feel like that's always a recipe for disaster because it lowers and lowers and lowers and lowers the bar. New works should be the engines that drive us as a culture forward. They should ask questions that we didn't know we were interested in the answers to. They should provide answers that we disagree with and then we fight back. New works should be the things that are pushing us forward, but instead they're increasingly relegated to tiny little places, the little theater aside the main one, the one that is sort of should be the engine, but is kind of the caboose of theatrical production. We don't have, you think it's bad in France, I mean, we don't have many commercial, we don't have many governmental funds, to put it mildly, for new work. And if if the United States wants to give money to theatrical productions, it is probably not to an extraordinarily strange, non-linear, devised work with a script that is unreadable to somebody outside of the theater, right? Finally, Nathalie was talking about, where's the audience my age at the theater? And in the States, the answer is they often can't afford it. Ticket prices are exceptionally high, but because of course the theaters need to make money. There's no other way to stay alive, but of course that prices out a lot of our youth. The thing that makes me happy, which is this, right? People who continue to do new work and to translate new work and to produce new work, even though there is no incentive to do so whatsoever. We've been talking this week a bit about a wonderful man of the theater, Paul Schmidt, who many of us had the pleasure of knowing, and he made a huge impact on me when I met him in graduate school, and he was a translator, actor, a poet, a playwright, a director, a dramaturg, and he said to us pretty much on the first day of class, he said, I decided I was going to be a Renaissance man of the theater. No one wanted a Renaissance man of the theater, but I decided to be one anyway. And that's something I keep so close to my heart, right? Maybe nobody wants, our works right now, but I think without it, things look even more dire. So the positive thing is then that we're here. We're here at 11 a.m. with Carnival going all around us, and we've translated plays that nobody begged us to translate, and we've directed them. And we've had new ideas. I was thinking today when we were that one of the Russians was talking earlier about the list of American playwrights that they've translated, and they were extraordinarily difficult playwrights, Susan Lloyd Hartz and Mack Wellman, and I was so impressed. And it gave me the courage to propose to Eric, who's going to be surprised to hear this. But one of the most exciting French playwrights, aside from the three here, is Valère Nourina, who is truly an athlete of the word, right? An athletic playwright, linguistically extraordinary, and he has hardly been translated into English at all, let alone produced. And it's incredibly difficult. They don't make sense. They're not punctuated. They go on and on and on. There's plays on words. It's extraordinarily difficult, but I figured, look, if somebody is going to do it, maybe we should do it. So that's my positive note that I'll end on.
Thank you. Someone else? Yes.
Thank
Hey, I'm Rob Melrose, and I'm the artistic director of the Cutting Ball Theater, and I'm also a translator for the festival. Well, I want to start by saying I'm really inspired by this conversation. I think this really put wind in my sails, and thank you, Amy and Yvonne and Denny, for putting this together, because I think this is an exciting group of people. So this is really great. I'm really excited about, I grew up and, you know, I started going to theater in the 80s, and I lived in Minneapolis, where Garland Wright and Nuki Chule were head of the Guthrie Theater, so I was used to director's theater, Robert Woodruff, Joanna Galitis, Richard Foreman, lots of, and I was really inspired by it, and it was really, really cool, and so I have a great love for it. And I love what Yuri said about this kind of healthy competition between director's theater and playwright's theater, and, I love it that in the past 10 years, playwrights have been more empowered, there's been more money for playwrights, and it's been, I think that's been really positive. And I'm looking forward to the next 10 years where we are talking about playwrights being residents at theaters and having long relationships with theaters, because I think the only downside of the past 10 years is with playwrights being empowered but not being parts of theaters, I feel like I've seen a lot of new plays that felt like television, I feel like that's been kind of a very poor experience, and I've just had these really great experiences with Eugenie Chan and with Andrew Saito, because they've been really involved with the project of the Cutting Ball Theater. They've seen our productions of Ionesco. They've seen our productions of Shakespeare. They've seen our productions of Susan Laurie Parks, and they've been inspired by it. And they have a sense of what we're doing, and so we're inspiring each other. And Eugenie's been our resident playwright for 4 years. And I think that's one of the reasons why she was able. We've done plays that she's just written kind of on her own, but we've also done her plays that she's written very much in collaboration with the company. And Tongvald was definitely a healthy competition between a director's theater and a playwright's theater, and it was a beautiful a beautiful result. And I think it's, we forget sometimes that Shakespeare, not only was responding to classical works, he wasn't writing just original stuff that just came to his mind. He was very much involved in a classical tradition. I just got done directing Troilus and Cressida, which is basically Shakespeare's response to the Iliad and Chaucer. But also, they were writing for theaters, Shakespeare, he had a relationship. He was part owner of the Globe Theater, so he knew he was a man of the theater and knew what he was writing for. He wasn't just off on his own writing stuff. He was very much involved in the theater making. There's also a theater called the Comédie Française, which some of you have heard of, and Molière was writing for that theater. And I'm very excited about the next 10 years, which I think will be, I'm looking forward to being the best example of director's theater and playwright's theater coming together. And I think a big part of that is funding coming down the pike. I don't know if you know, the Mellon Foundation is putting money into having, is it a secret? Oh, shit. erase this. It's exciting that there's going to be there are people out there who are interested in the idea of playwrights being associated with the theater on a long term basis, and we've done it on our shoestring budget, and it's yielded very, very positive results. I'm just unbelievably excited about, you know, who knows what, you know, whoever gets it, it doesn't matter. And it's gonna be a great move for the American theater, because it's gonna be this wonderful, you know, relationship which I've experienced. The thing I haven't experienced is having the playwright also making a living wage. Yeah. And I think having the playwright associated with theater, making a living, being a part of theater, that's gonna be unbelievably exciting. So I hope this becomes a trend, and that's what we see in the next 10 years. Thanks.
No, yes, the Mellon Foundation is funding. I believe it's going to be eight to ten playwright residencies. And yeah, I can't say more about it now, but I will be able to after June. So, are there any other? Is there any other burning?
The thing that I want to talk about the future, at least what I would like to happen in the Russian theater, is what is happening about translation and promotion of the Russian theater abroad and collaborations between Russian playwrights and playwrights from all over the world. I personally do not believe in the colonization in the art, because notwithstanding the Royal Court and the British Council and other cultural organizations, Goethe Institute and the Alliance Française, are doing their cultural projects and meeting us with other people and other techniques, it's only tools which we are used to produce our own art, our words of our hearts and minds. And I do believe in that. And I think that the translations, I am personally translating the drama, at least I'm trying to do that because I'm not a professional philologist, but I adore it. And I do want to see more cooperation between the translators of the drama, professional seminars, enrichment of our techniques and stuff and understanding the language. Yes! Yes, and the mixture of translators and playwrights, because when a translator working directly with a playwright, the translation will be better. And I really look forward for more projects in this field.
This has been an incredibly fruitful conversation. At the moment, it's going to come to an end, but we're encouraging you to go onto Twitter, and it's hashtag #NewPlay, NewPlayTV, or De Voix, and you can continue the conversation there. Really beautiful and interesting dialogue that we've had today. And yes, I do want to plug the Maison en Trois Vitesses, because it's exactly what you're talking about. And I think that these many ideas coming together within the context of translating across borders and having writers from Russia, writers from the former Yugoslavia, writers from Serbia, Soviet Bulgaria, and Siberia, which for us is like, whoa. That's really far, and from South America and the Americas in general, etc. Being able to connect this kind of visceral art that we do, and to sort of infect the rest of society with it would be a really exciting next 10 years. We do need to end, unfortunately, but we are gonna, and that is because Judith Miller, to my right, and Laurent Mulhausen here, are going to be leading a panel in about a half an hour or so, in a half an hour or less, on translation. And the translators from the De Voix Festival will be speaking, Judith will be speaking as well, and we hope you return for that. So there are food trucks a block away. Don't get lost. Come back.
At the carnival?
Yeah, go to the carnival and get a taco, or you know, something else.
thank you.
And come back. What time is it right now?
It's
1:05. So we're going to start at 1:30. So in 25 minutes, yeah. Please come on back and we will resume. Thank you very, very much.